Testing. I'm Peter Shook, and this is my colleague, Cliff Rogers. Hello.
Yes, and we are both working at Bendu. Working at BenduWorks, and here today to talk to you about closure hash maps and how there's plenty of room at the bottom, some improvements to the base hash map that Clojure uses and a lot of other languages, and that you can find us at these handles online that I'm spinning Tops of Doom on GitHub and Clojurians.
And I'm 2Cliff on Twitter and Cliff on many other platforms like Clojurians. And you can also find BenduWorks on various social media platforms at BenduWorks. So the topic today is going to be about building an alien spaceship.
Yep, how to avoid various problems like how to avoid the gray goo scenario when you have working nanomachines, because that's always on first thing on your mind when you actually have them.
And always wondering what cup of tea is best to power your infinite improbability drive. And as Captain Picard taught us, it's Earl Grey hot.
Yes. And for when you want to impress visitors to your spaceship, how to make it bigger on the inside than on the outside. That's always an important thing.
But this is really just a joke. We're here to talk about real alien technology, and that is secret Lisp alien technology.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. And that it's about immutability, one of the cornerstones of functional programming, that it is used in all of these languages as its the core data types are immutable, like in Scala, Elixir, Pascal and Clojure. All their data and data types are immutable by default, and they don't have any immutable constructions on there. And why would we want immutability? Well, there's a lot of reasons, for when you have deeply nested heterogeneous structures, like a very big configuration file, and you want to make a small change deep in that configuration, that unless you are doing a lot of copying or a lot of very strict programming, that change will propagate everywhere else, and you'll get a lot of bugs and errors because you're making a change that is instantly propagated, and that with immutable data structures, you can fire them off to other parts of your code and forget about them. You don't have to worry about somebody changing and having spooky accident distance. And also that a lot of people that are not familiar with functional programming assume that immutable data structures are going to be a lot slower in all cases than their mutable counterparts, but for diffing between two different data structures, that immutable data structures are actually much, much faster at doing the differentiation because you just can check pointer equality rather than having to go throughout the whole data structure. And one pretty most famous example that I could think of was React with should component update goes much, much faster when you're using immutable data structures than when you're using its mutable counterparts.
Yes, but there's always a catch, right? And as Peter alluded to, there's the fact that typically these implementations have been orders of magnitude slower than their mutable counterparts, mm-hmm. and that efficient implementations often come with constraints, such as requiring sortable keys, and storing the deltas in the data structure itself. So sortable keys, of course, is possible, but it sets requirements for the programmer to have to think of whether this data structure is appropriate for a given problem. And storing the data, the deltas in the data structure increases memory overhead because you actually have to store that data along with the actual data that you're interested in. So today we're going to talk about hash array map tries or trees, and we tend to pronounce them tries. I guess in German you may pronounce it trees, so Peter, can you tell us a little bit about those?
Sure, Cliff. Hash array map tries were brought into common practice about 8 or 9 years ago, and that they only have about 2 to 3 times the overhead as opposed to other common immutable data structures, and that the only complexity that is required for the keys is that they be hashable instead of having them having to be sortable or anything like that. So that means that you can store a heterogeneous collection of keys inside of your hash map, and that you can actually like store sets, maps, or other collections as keys inside of your map instead of having to be constrained to like simple data types like strings and numbers like that. And that greatly reduces the cognitive overhead, especially with people coming in from more imperative type languages like Python, Ruby, or JavaScript, which are used to just shoving anything inside the key and shoving any values in there, that they can jump right in and use these just like they would inside their more mutable hash map counterparts.
Yeah, and so the implementation that we'll talk about today was presented in a paper by Michael Steindorfer and Jürgen Vinyu. And this paper is titled Optimizing Hash Array Mapped Tries for Fast and Lean Immutable Java Virtual Machine Collections. And that's kind of a mouthful to say. So we're using the acronym that they've presented, CHAMP.
Yeah. Compressed Hash Array Map Try, or CHAMP, which is much shorter than that mouthful of the paper title. Mm-hmm.
And today we're going to be presenting a closure script implementation of CHAMP that you can find on GitHub under BendyWorks repositories, under the Lean Map repository if you're interested.
Yep, and CHAMP gives us guaranteed performance improvements over the original hash array map try. It gives us 2x speed up for iteration and orders of magnitude 10 to 100 times speed up for equality checking over the original implementation inside of Clojure and Clojure script.
Yeah. So that's the spoiler warning. This is the good stuff we're giving right here.
TLDR. So not only do we get these performance speed ups, but we also save memory overhead as well when we're using CHAMP hash maps, that they trim the maps down to a smaller size.
And this sounds like magic or wizardry.
That often people think of data structures as dark magic, and especially performant immutable data structures as very deep dark magic that you need to perform sacrifices on full moons and know all sorts of magic words like Klaatu, Vaktu, Nikta, things like that in order to understand. But what we found out while we were implementing this data structure was that it actually made them a lot more wieldy, that it made them easier to reason about and simpler to understand, that the code size, when all was said and done, was about only 2/3 the size of the original closure script implementation. So now we have a hat trick of better performance, lower memory overhead, and simpler to understand and reason about. Mm-hmm.
So now we're going to take you through an overview of the original Clojure hash map.
Yes, the Clojure hash maps under the hood are a tree of nodes with a 32-way branching factor. That you can see here, there's top of the root node, and there's various subnodes, and then leaf nodes with the that can have up to 32-way branching, which makes the tree very, very shallow, and consequently lookup addition deletion very, very fast. And then inside the node internals, we have an array with keys and values and references to nodes below it, along with metadata that tells the node where to find keys inside the array. So in this example, the key foo is located at element 0, and the key 3 is located at element 2, and the metadata tells us where to find that location so that when we're doing lookups or any sort of operation on that we can find them. And then the other question is like how do we find the node inside of this tree? That we take the key, we hash it, getting this huge long number, then we split that hash into chunks of 5 bits. As you can see, the first 5 bits are 20, and the second 5 bits are 10, et cetera, et cetera. And then what we do is we go to the root node and say, take the first 5 bits of that hash, say, give me the key inside of that node, and says, I don't have it, it's on the lower level of the node. So we go down the level, and then we take the next 5 bits and say, here's a hash, give me the value. It says, try again, and go down one more level, and finally, at the second level of the tree, we have finally the value when we take the hash of 18 and we get the value out of that. And with that overview, we'll now go on to the first improvement of CHAMP of how it increases iteration speed, doubling it, and that's by removing a lot of the complexity around subnode references.
What's a subnode reference, Peter?
Well, subnode references are basically the pointers to nodes below itself in the tree. So inside the original implementation, that subnodes are marked as a pseudo key value pair where they will have nil as the key that will indicate that their next slot is a pointer pointing below to a subnode. So as you can see in this example, there's key value, and then finally there's a nil key, which indicates that this is not a key value pair, but actually a subnode reference pointing below to the next node. And this, of course, has a problem of doubling the overhead for all subnode references. And so adds a lot of insulating complexity. This means that our hash map now has to have two fields to store the flag in case there's a nil key. You have to store that, and you also have to store the value for that nil key if it actually exists. And there's also an optimization that is needed that is called an array node, which is different than the node that we showed you, which just contains subnode references instead of key values. And that happens when you get a full node, a full normal node of 32 elements. And also that it has a lot of complications with the second problem.
What's the second problem?
The second problem is that subnode references, we don't know where they're located, so they're scattered all throughout the array, where you can see right here that there's key value, subnode reference, key value, subnode reference. And this means that when we're doing any sort of operation on a hash map try, that we have to always have a conditional check that we also have to ask whether we're doing adding a key value, looking up, or deleting it. We also have to check, are you actually a key value or are you a subnode reference whenever we're doing any sort of operation there. This just adds a lot of mental overhead and complexity to our code. Mm-hmm. And this makes iteration a WikiWalk.
And we're going to explain what a WikiWalk is.
Yes, as not everybody knows it. So, say example that you want to learn about the Roman Empire, so you go on the Wikipedia page for that. Then you start reading and say, ooh, the Roman Republic, that looks interesting. So you open a new tab on there, and then you get the Roman Republic with ancient Roman civilization is interesting as well, so you click on that, adding another tab. Then you do this like 30 or 40 times, lots more link tabbing and clicking. And then you finally come to the final page of awareness with this whole nice description with no more links for you to click. And then the question that I pose to everybody is, what was the next word after the Roman Republic? Does anyone remember it?
Yeah, does anyone recall?
I know I had the memory of goldfish.
Yeah. And this sounds like what I do on my computer all the time, but I don't remember either.
Yes.
So if we scroll back, we can see that the next word after Roman Republic was period.
Yes.
And this is demonstrating through human computers that WikiWalks are not very good at maintaining locality.
Yes, that because we have to keep on going, traversing the tree, going up and down, that our locality is basically shot when we're doing iteration, that our CPUs, which guess that we're going to be doing things very close in space and time, their castages are just shot, and it just makes it for much slower than it needs to be. So how does CHAMP improve this? Well, it does it through improving the nodes. That first improvement that it makes is that instead of having the subnode references sprinkled all around, that you can see that the key values are in the front and the subnode references are in the back, making things much more organized. And we split up or decomplex the metadata into key value metadata and subnode reference metadata, where that allows us to always know if we're looking at keys or values or looking at subnode references so that we never have to ask the question, what are we looking at? And this has the obvious benefit right away that it gets rid of the overhead for subnode references because we no longer have to have that nil marker value. We can always know where we're going, so we don't need to have that marker anymore. And look at all this incidental complexity that we can get rid of, that we no longer need any special fields in our top-level data structure of keeping track of a nil key or of nil value. We no longer need a special case of array nodes to do the optimization, and we no longer have to keep on asking, are you a key value or are you subnode reference, that we automatically know due to the splitting apart of the metadata.
Yeah, and so all this leads to a doubling of speed, or a 2x speed up, for CHAMP's iteration versus the original hash map from Clojure, and it changes the iteration from a wiki walk to a linear scan. And so if we walk through the original hash map algorithm broken down into pseudocode, you can see that it's already kind of confusing. There's a conditional at the beginning where you check whether the key you're looking at is a nil. If it's a nil flag, then you return a tuple of nil and the nil value. For normal nodes, you check whether the key is not nil, in which case you return the key value pair. Otherwise, you go on to the subnode, because if you're not in a normal key, you're in a subnode reference, so you follow it and repeat, again, kind of traversing that wiki walk. For the specialized array node, you check whether the element is nil. If it is, you continue. Otherwise, you go on to the subnode and repeat. Again, that array node is a specialized node that's only holding references to subnodes, and we'll talk a bit more about that as we continue. So contrast that complicated algorithm that it took me a few minutes to explain with the CHAMP iteration algorithm, which is simply two steps. The first one is iterate through the key value pairs, which you know about because of the metadata, and then subsequently iterate through the subnodes, repeating the first step. So by comparison, you can see that in terms of lines of code, we're comparing 7 pseudocode lines of code with 2 lines. We have removed all of the conditionals in the CHAMP implementation, so we go from 3 conditionals to none, and we no longer have that subtle polymorphism between regular nodes and the specialized array node data type. So that summarizes how CHAMP improves iteration, and now we're going to move on to talk about the improvements for equality checks of hash maps.
Yes, and we have audience participation here. We have a Clojure puzzler that I like to call sloppy cleaning. And so in this code example, we start out with a empty hash map. We add 1 million key value pairs in full map, and then we remove all the key value pairs from full map, getting that to the same map, and then we compare the two empty hash maps, and they are equal according to Clojure. And so that the question we pose to you in the audience is that for if we want to do the operation of putting all the key values of our maps into an empty hash map for the base map that is 140 microseconds, the question that we have is how long will this take in the same map, which has exactly the same number of key value pairs as an empty hash map? So I think that since they're the same maps, that they should be about the same speed. So I'm going to go with answer A, that they should take 140 microseconds, because that just seems logical. What about you, Cliff?
I'm just going to copy off of your paper and say A as well. Why don't we ask the audience? Yes. Do we have any A's? Yes. Oh, you're too smart for us. Yes. How about any B's, that it would take twice as much time?
Not very participative.
Yeah. Any C's? Okay, we're seeing some C's, that it might take 10 times as long. Yeah. Any D's, 100, or is that 1,000 times, or 100 times, yeah, as long?
We got a few more.
Okay.
And how many at E? How many think that it takes almost 200 times as long to do that? And we got one lone person back
there. One very smiling person in the back.
Drum roll, please.
Yeah, drum roll. The answer is, in fact, E. It's always E. You should, yes, always guess E.
Yes. And, well, it's very interesting as to why this is. And to get into why this is the case, we have to go through the original deletion algorithm. And that's what it's very naive inside of the original implementation that just navigates to the key that you want to delete in the node where the key is contained, for this example, 3, and says remove the node, remove the key value from that node's array, generating a new array, and doing the path copying for persistent data structure. And that is the naive implementation. And this leads to this nice little horror story of we have this innocent little hash remap try with all these nice key values, and we want to slip it apart and remove all its key values. And what you're about to see is kind of horrifying. So if you have weak constitutions, you may want to look away.
Thank you. I'll look away.
Sorry, it was very frightening. And as you can see, this data structure is pretty much the same as this if you look at it structurally, that none of the nodes are removed at all. It has the exact same structure and has empty nodes where the keys and values should be. And this is the problem with the naive implementation, that when you do deletion, you may get rid of the keys and the values, but you don't actually get rid of any of the structure or any of the leaf nodes. And this is why it took 200 times as long in order to do that same operation, where that we may have deleted all the 1 million keys and values, but according to the map, there are still, looks like there are still 1 million keys and values there, so that we're actually iterating over 1 million keys and values when we're trying to put things in, according to the map. And that's why it took so long.
Yeah. So now we're going to look at how CHAMP improves this.
Yeah, so what CHAMP does is says, all right, if you're deleting, you can still do the same operation, but if my node only contains an array with a key and value, then we move it up one level to the parent's subnode and replace the parent's array with the new array that has that subnode's key value in there, and that for in the case that where there's a path for it to follow, like there's another node, parent node is just an empty subnode reference, then we continue up the tree until we find a node that the array does not just contain an empty subnode reference, that we keep on going till it actually has more than one subnode reference or key value pairs.
So this gets rid of all those leftover array nodes that we saw in the original implementation.
Yeah, that gets make sure that we don't have any more empty nodes or empty structural nodes which are not used anymore. And this has the obvious benefit of lowering the memory overhead because we no longer have empty nodes or empty structural nodes.
Yeah, so what? So this only really matters in pathological cases. We don't often, or I hope we don't, in production, create a million keys in a map and then immediately turn around and remove those million keys. Maybe there's some specialized cases where you would want to do that. How does this work in kind of more realistic cases?
Yeah, the benefit for all this, the payoff, is that when you now have CHAMP hash maps, that if they are equal in the number of the key values, that they are actually equal in memory, so that you can compare them via their nodes instead of their key values, that no matter what additions or deletions you do for the CHAMP maps, that they are still going to be the same nodes with the same arrays inside of memory, so that you can do comparison directly on nodes via pointer equality instead of having to directly look at in the arrays keys and values. And this leads to the 100 times performance improvement that you saw in our previous slides, and that's because it's logarithmic time as opposed to linear time, that we can directly compare nodes, which is pointer equality checks, and we can do this in logarithmic time since the tree structure is very, very shallow. And this is assuming that maps share structure.
So what if they don't share structure?
Well, then we still get a 10 times performance improvement if they don't share structure, and this is because we can directly look inside the nodes and compare their arrays instead of having to use higher level abstractions like the current implementation does, where it uses the closure iteration and lookup abstractions that says, here's the first hash map, go throughout all your keys and values and look up on the second one all the values for the keys on that map and compare their values. And that uses very high level abstractions that don't have the great locality that comparing to arrays does inside of the.
And sorry, I jumped the gun there. I think we should go back and explain what we mean by maps that share structure.
Yes, that under the hood, that when you make a new, when you add or remove something from a closure hash map, that it has structural sharing, which means that the original hash map try just does path copying and shares a lot of the nodes from the other hash map try. So in this example, you can see that the pink and the blue nodes share a lot of structure there, that the green nodes are shared between them. And so for the comparison where they're sharing structure, that we can do pointer equality checks for all the green nodes. And in this case, we can stop right there and don't have to worry about traveling any further deep down the tree and only need to actually do comparisons of key values between the pink and the blue nodes.
Yeah, and so that's where you see the difference between the 100 and 10 times performance changes.
And of course, there's always some caveats. I have been asked, like, why isn't this in production yet? And the JavaScript implementation is still about 8% slower than the original closure script implementation for adding our association, and is about 10 to 20% lower for deletion. And this is because the original algorithm was in Java and built in mind for the JVM. And to get the performance speed to the original closure script version, it involved diving deep into JavaScript JIT details, which is very, very undocumented, at least relative to JVM JIT, and is very maddening to try and bang your head against. So that's why it hasn't been implemented yet, because we're still trying to figure out that last little bits of performance. But the JVM version has been about is comparable speed for all operations compared to the closure hash map try that is used in Rascal, that the paper offers actually wrote the data structure to use in Rascal, another JVM language, and that Christopher Grand has ported their version over to Java using closures hashing and then comparisons, and the speeds are roughly the same between the two versions. Mm-hmm. So it's just the JavaScript JITs that are causing us trouble. Yeah. So that we think that champ makes this paves the way for a lot of future improvements, and makes the particularly because it makes hash map tries a lot easier to reason about and think about more than the current version.
Yeah, so this means that rather than worrying about how the JavaScript JIT is working and how your specialized array node is working, you can just worry about the hard problem, the undocumented JIT, and not worry about how your complicated data structure works. So hopefully this will lead to more people, more eyes on the problem, and more performance gains in the future.
Yes, and two future possibilities that we're excited about are doing merging and diffing of hash maps, that we think this will be similar to RRB vectors, that for normal vector concatenation or merging of two vectors, it's linear time, but for RRB vectors, due to knowledge of the tree structure, you can get logarithmic time by magically going through the tree and adding combining the nodes instead of the values. So we are imagining that you can do the similar thing with these new improved champ map. And that although some interesting work has been done by Christopher Grand, he's started work on a project called Confluent Map that, in addition to trying to solve the merge problem, has done some other interesting ideas, such as storing the in the metadata whether a tree is a persistent or immutable tree as a mutable tree, so that you can flip back and forth between mutable and immutable versions depending on what you want to do, and to get rid of small marker objects which are currently used in the closure version, that they, in order to mark if you're adding and deleting, is actually adding or removing a node to keep the counts, to keep track of the counts. They are small marker objects which slow things down by adding extra allocation overhead, and he's looking at removing that overhead as well. And of course, the big thing that he's working on is getting the mergeability of closure hash maps so that we can have merging of two maps in logarithmic time as linear time. So CHAMP is not as cool as working nanobots, unfortunately, but we both think that it's a really amazing piece of alien Lisp technology, so it's got that going for us.
Yeah, and so what we've shown today is that CHAMP demonstrates that hash maps have plenty of room at the bottom, so there's still room for performance gains compared to the original implementation of the hash array mapped tree. We showed two times performance speed up for iteration and 10 to 100 times speed up for equality checking, depending on which case you're using, whether you share a lot of structure or have kind of set, different data structures. And we've demonstrated that there's lower memory overhead because you don't have to store the nil references for the subnodes.
Or have empty nodes hanging around taking up space.
When you delete, yeah.
Yeah, but for me, the biggest win was that it actually made hash array mapped tiles a lot easier to understand and reason about and implement. That I do think that one of Clojure's best exports is its hash maps, that since they came about, that they've been implemented as the base like data type for Elixir, Clojure, and Scala, and for the non-functional languages like Ruby or JavaScript, there's libraries which basically copy the implementation for that, like immutable JS and Hamster, both have hash array map tries as their immutable data structure for Ruby, and that our hope is that we will see this like type of immutable data structure propagated throughout more languages in the future.
And fingers crossed that we will likely see similar performance gains in those languages as well.
Yeah. And we have a long list of thanks that people that supported us, that BendyWorks supported us by flying us out here all the way from Madison, Wisconsin, or Philadelphia, as in my colleague's case, and gave us the time to work on this. And we'd like to thank Michael Steindorfer and Hergen Vinyu for the paper and actually having a working implementation, which made things a lot easier. And Zach Tellman, who wrote Collection Check, a property-based testing library for hash maps to make sure that if you do have a hash implementation that it actually works and all the corner cases are taken care of. And for Martin Klepsch, who ported over to ClojureScript, it was really written just in Clojure. And Nicholas Berger, who helped me set up the test harness to make sure that this is all testing and working and not just some weird edge case. And finally, David Nolan, who helped me flesh out the rough draft of this version with performance and profiling suggestions.
And with that, we're finished. We're happy to take any questions. Questions?
Okay, so my question is related to JVM. So I understood that this is faster and better on ClojureScript. What about JVM? You mentioned something, but it was not clear to me. Should we expect the same speed up and on JVM or not?
So the paper was an implementation on the JVM. In a different language, but they saw similar performance to the original implementation on the JVM. So the explanation for that is that so much time has gone into improving compilation on the JVM that there may be some optimization there that might be responsible for that performance.
What we were talking about for the comparison between the JavaScript JITs and the JVM was comparing the addition and deletion. Everything else is the same performance or better on the JVM version, but the JavaScript version is currently a little bit slower on addition and deletion, but the same performance benchmarks are the same between the two versions. Well, you should use them since this is not currently ported over.
If it were ported.
Yeah.
I was talking with some of the Clojure maintainers, and they currently aren't working on this since they were looking at somebody to flesh this out and prove this out. And I'm currently working on getting the JVM version, but my Java is not as good as my Clojure scripts, so I'm still having troubles there porting it over. And if somebody wants to help, that would be great. But so far, there's been little traction outside of me and the original author implementations. I haven't seen in like the year that's passed anybody that's been jumping on to implement this.
Do you have some more background on the original implementation? So somebody must have thought this was a good idea to put these nil references in the middle of the hash. Do you know why this was decided? Does it have any advantage?
I do not know the original author. As far as like looking up stuff that I can tell, that was originally Phil Bagwell in 2001 that wrote the I forget the paper, but it was like optimal hash maps that was dealing with the tree structure instead of the normal flat array structure where you double in size if you fill up to certain capacity. And I know that it was Rich Hickey who ported this and made this immutable version. So I have no idea as regards to why that worked. I would have guessing that he was like creating it whole cloth, so he was just getting it working on the mutable version as opposed to getting any performance gains.
Yeah, I think I have a question about the algorithm. So in the initial thing you said, and maybe that also connects to the previous question. So my impression was that you had these slots because you have these 5-bit addresses inside of the nodes, right? And so I was wondering, so once you squeeze things in the way you do, somehow the addresses also change, right?
Could you repeat the last, what was the last part of the question?
So in the original node layout, right?
Yeah.
So you have like 32 slots in the node, and they're addressed by these 5-bit parts of the hash, right?
Yep.
Okay, then you don't know whether there's a key at that point or whether the tree goes on, right?
Yes.
So now when you arrive at a node, then you look at this 5-bit thing, and then you just look at the slot, and you know how to carry on, right?
Right.
So now when you just move all the key values to the front, what's the address? How do you know which of those keys you need to look at if you?
Okay, I understand.
I think the answer is in the metadata.
Yeah, the metadata is split up into the key value metadata and the subnode metadata, so that if you're looking at the key value metadata, it assumes the original structure of everything's in the front, so that like slot 0 is slot 0 and that slot 2 is in slot 2. But for the subnode references, it says take the array length and then subtract it so that the subtract the array length from the node and do a little bit of additional fiddling to get the subnode references. And they, in the paper, they explained that they tried putting the subnode references in the front, but that meant they had to do some more tricky calculations, so that's why they have the key values in the front and the subnode references in the back. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think so. So you essentially first look at
Yeah, that you look in the key value bitmap and it'll be always in the front portion of the array, and if you look in the subnumber of the key map metadata, it'll always be in the back of the array. So that's how the computation is.
Yeah. Thank you. Lunch.